your talk.
Hello, and thank you very much for inviting me to this conference. I'm here to present something about our work that we have started about 2 years ago at University of Sarajevo School in Science and Technology. And given that I'm a microbiologist, I'm first going to introduce you to the beauty of microbiome in general. So I'm going to first give you an introduction to human microbiome. Then I'm going to explain in a little bit more detail how do we study populations of diverse microbes. And last but not least, I'm going to give you some of the information about our study. So I'm going to start at the very beginning, at the birth of our planet, just to remind you that the first and most abundant organisms on the planet are microbes. They are actually bacteria. And they have evolved before everyone else, so they are very well adapted to living on this planet. And you can find them in almost every imaginable habitat on this Earth, ranging from the hot springs in Yellowstone National Park, where the temperatures exceed 80 degrees Celsius, to the rocks where the radiation mimics that of in space. And given that, they are very, very diverse. So let me show you this phylogenetic tree on the right side of the panel. And you can see that everything that is in the canopy of this tree is actually bacteria, while we are only one leaf in the bottom right corner belonging to the eukaryotes. So at the moment that we began evolving, we have been colonized inside and out by bacteria, and we have been co-evolving with them ever since, up to a point where we depend on them to encode some functions that we cannot encode ourselves in our genomes. So some of the scientists actually consider humans to be superorganisms, just a mere conglomerate of human and bacterial cells. So these communities that live in and on us are called microbiomes, and we have many of them. We have a skin microbiome, we even have breast milk microbiome. Some of them are even advocating for placenta microbiome. But nowhere do we get so many different species and such a large density of microbes than we do in the human gut. And as you can see, they are changing throughout the gut and they are reaching trillions of bacteria in the colon. And you have to understand that these bacteria are not just sitting there, they're actively functioning. So for example, they are involved in maturation of immune system. They help degrade foods. They synthesize vitamins that we can't ourselves, and so on and so on. So which are the most important bacteria that we have in our guts? So we have four different phyla. So let me just remind you a little bit about taxonomy for those that are rusty a little bit. So we have a topmost level of kingdom, then we have a phylum. It's a very, very broad group of organisms. And then it goes all the way down to family, genus, and species. However, only two of these phyla are common to all humans, and they are called bacteroidetes and firmicutes. And as you can see, they have very diverse functions that are doing in the gut. And it is their ratio that is used as an indicator of dysbiosis. This is why I'm mentioning them. But apart from that, we are very, very heterogeneous when it comes to bacteria. In fact, we are only sharing about 30% of all bacteria that are in our gut. So everything rest is unique to the individual. So the next question would be, why do we have such a heterogeneity? Why do we need to do studies repeatedly and repeatedly in different geographic locations? So some of the diversity is obviously encoded in the genome. So we have a strong genetic component, but everything else comes from the environment. So it is geographical location, as I have mentioned. And then many other factors. Someone has mentioned mode of delivery, antibiotics, stress, and most importantly, diet. And we have some proof for this. So here are the results from a study that was published in 2012 in Nature, where they have been investigating the impact of diet on three different populations. The US population, which is consuming high fat, low fiber diet, and the Malawian and Amerindian populations, which are consuming high fiber diet. So here we have a plot, it's a PCOA plot. I think you already seen one today. And in this case, every dot represents a single microbiome. So if the two dots are closer together, they are more related. And if they are separate, they are more diverse. So you can see here that the American population, is completing, is grouping completely differently from the two other populations. So now for the second part, I'm going to explain to you how do we conduct these studies. So for the longest time in microbiology, we have been using something that is called the pure culture approach. So we would go to the environment, take a sample from the environment, plate it on a well-defined media, and observe microbes as single colonies. And this has worked extremely well for us. So this way we have been able to isolate most of the bacterial pathogens. But once we get to the environment, we can realize that the microbes do not live alone. They live in tight-knit communities where they are exchanging nutrients, where they are actively communicating together, and where they depend on one another. So this is how we understood that about 99% of microbes that live on this planet we cannot obtain in pure culture. That is, we cannot study their physiology. So how do we tackle that? We have four different approaches. So we have a DNA approach, we have an RNA approach, we have a protein-based approach, and then metabolite-based approach. But I'm only going to be talking about the DNA approach because this is what we have used in our study. So how do we do this? We go to the environment again, and this time around, we isolate complete community, total community DNA from the environment. And in case of the human, this will be a conglomerate of human cell DNA and microbial cell DNA. And then we have two possible pathways, and we have taken this first pathway that we are going to be talking, that I'm going to be talking about right now, and it's called the amplicon sequencing. So first, as a first step here, we have amplified a very special gene from the environment. It's called the 16S rRNA gene. And what makes it special is that it is unique to bacteria. So it is not present anywhere else in any other organism on the planet. So if you find a gene for 16S rRNA, you have found a bacterium. And what is even more exciting about this gene is that it is composed of two different regions. So there is a region which is unique to each of the bacterium, and it can define a species. So it's kind of like a fingerprint. The second approach is called metagenomic sequencing. We haven't been using it yet. We do plan to. And it's just sequencing of the entire DNA. So you get an insight into all genes that are present in the environment. So you get kind of like an insight into genetic potential of what they can do, as opposed to our approach, where you get an insight into who is present and who is absent in the community. And this is very useful when you are studying large cohorts in health and in disease. So this brings me to our little study that we have been doing from March 2020. I know March 2020 was a great time to start the study. So it was immediately postponed for about 9 months. And we have been recruiting children aged 3 to 11. The average age was about 6, both boys and girls. And we have collected 44 individuals, feces from 44 individuals with autism spectrum disorder and 24 from neurotypical controls. And neurotypical controls were matched by age and sex. So we have sequenced one of these or two of these hypervariable regions, they are called V3 and V4, on a sequencing platform MiSeq. And we have, for the purpose of classification, that my colleague Jasminka Hasic had done. We have collected a vast amount of metadata as well, and we have found some statistically significant differences, mostly in the frequency of gastrointestinal problems, and also some significant differences in eating habits. And now for the bioinformatical analysis, what we have done so far, this is all very fresh. We only got these results back about 1 month ago. So the first thing that we did was look into the alpha diversity. And what is alpha diversity? Alpha diversity is simply a measure of how many species do you have in your gut or any other environment. So let's say I have 100 species and somebody else has 120. So this other person's diversity is higher. And what you can see from this graph, which is presented a very simple index, it's Shannon index, it takes into account both the number of species and abundances, is that the children in a population of Bosnia and Herzegovina have less bacterial species than do neurotypical children. And in the second step, we wanted to see whether we can see some clouds. So we did the PCOA analysis. And here you have the red dots, children with ASD, and then the blue dots, the neurotypical children. And I was really hoping to see some clouding, some clear differentiation, but we didn't see that. So we couldn't conclude that the children with autism spectrum disorder have completely different microbiomes. In fact, they overlap. And then we went and looked into the literature, and I must say that it is not universally acknowledged that these microbiomes are different. So many other studies have gotten results like we had. So then we wanted to see whether we can see some differences in abundances of different phyla. So first we wanted to see whether the children with ASD have, do we get some proof of dysbiosis in children with ASD? And we actually did the Firmicutes bacteroidetes ratio that I was talking about earlier. And you can see that it was higher in the ASD group than in the NT group. That is indicative of the presence of dysbiosis. But when we wanted to see statistical differences, we only found one at the level of the phylum called Verrucomicrobia, which was depleted in the ASD group. And Verrucomicrobia, as you can read from the slide, are beneficial. So one of these beneficial groups is less represented than the others. And last but not least, we went to see what are the differences at genus level. And what I'm showing here is a heat map. So it's very simple to understand. Everything that is red is very abundant, and everything that is yellow is less abundant or very rare. So you can just visualize and compare the microbiomes over these heat maps. So you can see that the profiles of the children with ASD were different from those of neurotypical children. And within this, we tried to look for some biomarkers which can be used to distinguish these two groups. And as a result of this bioinformatic analysis, two genera came up, which were depleted in the ASD group. And one of them is Streptococcus, and the other one is a group of genera, is a group of bacteria that are clustering within Eubacterium Halley. And again, both of these are beneficial. They are producing either food for the gut cells that suppresses inflammation, or they are improving gut health and increasing nutrient absorption. So to conclude, our ASD group had lower alpha diversity, that is less species. We couldn't see any differences in beta diversity parameters on our PCOA plot. And differential taxa were Verrucomicrobia at the phylum level, and at the genus level, Eubacterium Halley and Streptococcus. And with that, I would like to thank you for your attention.